had taken off, and they were looking for some donkeys that had gone astray. Mm-hmm. And when those two donkeys, the donkeys went astray, his father told him, he said, Saul, he said, I want you to take the servant, and I want you to go out and find my lost donkeys. Yes. I need them back. And so they traveled through Ephraim, and they traveled through Cilicia, and through Shalem, and the Benjamite country, and then through Zup, and down they were at the country of Ramah. Some of us get all hung up in Ramah. Mm. This is where they are today, but some of us, we've been looking so hard for so much stuff. Mm-hmm. It ain't necessarily donkeys today, but you look for a lot of stuff that's not real. It's fake.
Amen.
And you get stuck in Ramah. But something special happened in Ramah because he had this servant with him. And I love the fact that the servant is the one who had a great idea. And Saul was smart enough to know it. And when the servant spoke to Saul and told him, he said, we've been through all these different lands and we ain't found what we're looking for. But I have an idea. He said, we can go and find the seer. And the seer, I don't want you to get it all mixed up. The seer, back in biblical days, was a prophet. So the servant said, I know where there is a seer. And the seer is an honorable man. He's a good man. We can trust him. Mm-hmm. So Saul says, well, we can go, but you know, whenever we go to see, and I want y'all to hear this part, whenever we go to see the prophet, we're supposed to be carrying gifts. And we don't run out. We've been looking all over Ephraim and Shalisha and Shalim and the Benjamite country, and we don't have nothing left. We can't go to the prophet without bringing a gift for his services. Here we go with the servant again. The servant said, look, I have a fourth of a shekel of silver. Uh-huh. And you can take that. And that's what we're going to give to the seer when we get there. And when we see him, we're going to ask him, should we keep on looking for the donkeys or should we go home? Should we throw in the towel and give it all up and go on back home? Or can he give us some direction about where we ought to go? Sometimes when we're stuck in Ramah, we ought to look to the prophet and ask him, ought we throw in the towel? Should we look further? What do we need to do, prophet? And so they set out to find him in the country of Ramah. When they did see him, guess what? They did not recognize that it was Samuel. I don't know whether the prophet looked more like a porter or a peasant or, you know, just pooped, I don't know. But he didn't recognize him as being the seer that they were looking for. Isn't that funny how that happens? Some will be smack dab in front of us, and we don't recognize it for what it is. We sit around and we complain about what we don't have, what we wish we had. We wish that it was so much better in our lives, when in fact, the Lord has already laid out the plan for you. He knew what you needed, and he knew what you would be seeking for. Sometimes it's just that stuff that glitters like gold, but it ain't worth a hoot. Oh my goodness. Some of us are sitting up in our houses right now with some hoots. It's tight.
Don't preach. Watch out.
It's tight. It's tight. But when Saul and the servant went to see Samuel, see, this is what I like. Some of us get all uptight when we start saying, ain't nobody serving. I ain't working for nobody. Mm. I ain't serving nobody. Mm. I want to be up front. No. I want to be at the head. But listen, this is what I want to tell you today. Now, this is so important. Look no further, for that which you seek, you have found. Amen. I love the fact that the servant was hanging with Saul. Mm-hmm. And he was doing what servants do. He was helping the master.
Amen.
And here's the best part. When you're hanging with the master and you're working for him, and I don't care if you you know, if you're pulling out the tissues from the tissue box from somebody in the service, or pulling out a fan somewhere with you, mopping in the kitchen from a spill, you know, I don't care what you're doing, you're serving.
Amen.
And here's the thing. When God gets ready to elevate your leader, your captain, when you get ready to elevate the man of God, being a servant is a good thing.
Yeah.
See, because when he found, when the two of them found Samuel, this is the great part. He said he set up a table that had already been prepared for Saul. And he said, bring your servant up to the head table with you.
Elevation. Come on and say amen. But I want to tell you what this text shows me is that this man man thought that an all-knowing God didn't know what he was doing.
All right.
That an all-wise God was about to make a mistake.
Yeah.
That he who searches high and searches our hearts had looked and couldn't find what he was looking for. I'm preaching right there. Are you kidding me? See, in Hebrew, we have to understand about the family. Oh, I helped somebody this afternoon. We have to understand that Benjamin, the Hebrew word for Benjamin, it means son of my right hand. It means son of the south. And traditionally, that name is known to stand for strength and virtue. But I'm going to help somebody. There was some debilitating activities that happened on the day that Benjamin was born. Come on and say amen. What happened was, you didn't know, only a select few knew, that he was born in Canaan, that his father was Jacob, that he was the last of 12 boys. Somebody say he was the run. That's the least. His mother was Rachel, but she had a hard labor. And because of her labor, instead of calling him Benjamin, she called him Benoni, which means son of my sorrow. That's why he thought he was the least of these, because his grandmama didn't think, oh, I'm going to help somebody tonight. His great-grandmama was passing on a blessing or a curse, amen, based on the name that she's giving him. Oh, watch while I preach this message. Are you kidding me? His name had crippled him from birth. But I tell you what happens is the mama says she's going to name him one thing, but the father in the family. That's why we need some fathers to stand up for what's right. Come on and say amen. Amen. Mama was thinking one thing, but daddy said, no, 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 he ain't going to be the son of sorrow. He ain't going to be the son of shame. He ain't going to be the son of disgrace, because this is my baby boy. We're going to name him Benjamin. Come on and say amen. See, we have to understand that things are happening in our past that come to speak up on us in our future. What you don't know about him, or you might not remember, is that Benjamin was born with, I said, 12 other boys. Amen. He was the least. He and his brothers were born to three separate women. I'm going to help you. Leah, right. Rachel, and a handmaiden, Zilpah, were all dating the same man.
Oh,
it was right there. But tell your neighbor, sister girl, it ain't right right now. Was a lot of jealousy. Amen. We have a tendency to be jealous when we think somebody else is getting blessed and our name don't go first. I want to tell you in this text that Rachel had to wait her turn. Somebody know about waiting their turn? But in this text, the egg that Benjamin came from was tainted with jealousy. Oh, you better be careful who you hook up with. Amen. The milk that Benjamin was drinking was robbed of its nutrients. Come on and say amen. We're talking about the family of God. So when God says he wants to do something, your mind automatically goes to the dysfunction of your family. Just look at your neighbor and say, are you kidding me?
Are you kidding me?
Come on and say that's right. See, what happened is Benjamin was staying in his brother's shadow. Y'all know his brother. His brother was Joseph. Genesis talks about it. He was the miracle child and he was the dreamer. But what about Benjamin? What about the Benjamins in the classroom? Just because they don't have a 4.0, where are my baby boy Benjamins? Come on, we need to look out for the Benjamins. My preacher preached the other week. He said, please, can somebody go get Tyrone? I tell you in this text that God was trying to go get Tyrone and he was trying to get Benjamin at the same time. Come on and say amen. I want to let you know that his older brothers on his daddy's side, somebody say daddy's side, they plotted to kill the brother Joseph. They sold him into slavery. They told their daddy that he was dead and they threw him in the pit. Y'all know the brothers. Y'all didn't know they were related. Somebody tell your neighbor, we related to the brothers too. See, Judges 20, it continued to happen throughout Benjamin's life. Judges 20 said that his brothers, the 11 tribes of Israel, even went so far as to wage in war against the Benjamite. See, that's a dirty little secret that don't nobody want to tell nobody. Everybody got a dirty little secret that won't nobody want to tell somebody. But you ought to expose the devil, tell the truth, and shame the devil. See, the brothers weren't what the people expected them to be. Amen. I tell you in this text, it tells me that while Benjamin was trying to sing, we are climbing Jacob's ladder, he couldn't do it. because he felt like he was the least. That's why you don't get in the choir, because your hum don't sound right when you singing beside Shanae. Come on and say it again. I'm preaching right here. I want to remind somebody that there's a quick point I want to make, and I feel somebody about to take this microphone right now. Amen. But there's a thing about a new family. God is reorganizing the family. He's telling you, don't worry what happened in your past. Don't try to second guess why it happened. Why they did what they did. Why did they make a bad marriage so long? Why did they get the hookup? Why were they upset with the situation? Amen. I want to tell you that this thing that God is showing me this afternoon, three quick points. He says in Ephesians 3 and 14, it says, for this cause I bow my knees unto the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family, somebody say the whole family, the whole family in heaven and earth is named. And so when you think about the family, that's all right, we know your story, but think about you not being the least, because one, you take after your daddy. God said, you take after me. Amen. The second thing he says is, you're a resident of the kingdom. Somebody say amen. And then the third thing he says is that your value is based upon the value of the family.
Amen.
Come on and say amen.
Amen.
So when you look at God, God said, I'm about to elevate the family.
Yes.
Don't you start second guessing God.
Right.
Jump in.
That's right.
And just ride the wave. Tell your neighbor, ride the wave.
Ride the wave. I want you to know that as we look at this, and as Saul spoke about feeling the least, the smallest, you know, that's not the only time that that happens in the Bible. You remember when Jesus was born in a town called Bethlehem? Mm-hmm. And Bethlehem in the Bible is spoken of as the least of the princes of Judah. But it wasn't. It held our Savior. That's where he came from. We need to stop people looking at our birth order.
Come on.
Stop looking at your birth order, your birthplace, your birth family. And cursing where you came.
Yeah.
We gotta stop that mess.
Yeah, come on.
We gotta stop that mess.
Yeah, you got some real black sheep in your family. I said, your family, you know, I turn that thing around to myself. You got a lot of black sheep in your family. Like you're wrong.
Some of you are blacker than others.
But when we begin to place ourselves in that lonely place,
because of where we see others, you make a mistake. Paul wasn't the only child. He was a rich man by those standards. And he came from a great place called him. But he still
less than the other richer people. Because
well,
it said his father was a prominent man. They had money. They had donkeys that run away. They had stuff. But he still saw himself as inconsequential. And wherever you see yourself is where you end up.
Well,
amen. We can't keep walking around people in yesterday's trouble.
Come on.
All right now.
Come on now. Because God said he had a plan for us. I'm looking for the plan.
Well,
if we are seeking for anything, we're seeking for the plan that God had from the beginning for your life. Stop stopping at Rhema, taking stock of where you are, and then you feel that you can't go any further. Mm-hmm. This is a place where a lot of people find themselves.
Well,
but I want you today to make a vow to yourself that it ends right here.
Amen.
It ends today. For my children, it ends right here.
Yeah.
I'm not speaking that negativeness again to them or to me.
Amen.
I have to speak life into my situation.
Yeah.
Jeremiah wasn't fooling around when he was talking about the plan of God. Saul was in it. Samuel was in it. The servant was in it, and they took their rightful place. When he chose Saul to to be the one to rule over Israel, the first king. He didn't make any mistakes. God didn't look at how handsome he was, because the words said the boy was mighty handsome. They didn't look at his height, because they say he stood shoulders above any other Israelite. And so those were the physical things, but God was looking at the heart.
And stop worrying about what people see when they look at the outside of you.
Yes.
Because God is not looking at the outside to make a decision on how he wants to use you. They say he came through 40 and 2 generations.
Yeah.
They didn't see about us. And he was full of riches. But he came unto his own, and his own received him not. And the scripture said he had nowhere to lay his head. But because the Lord, somebody say the Lord. But because the Lord had his hands on him. Don't you worry about where you started.
Yeah.
Just worry about where you're going to end up. Amen. And don't worry about if you burden them. Part two, because they stretch you high and hung you high early on your Sunday morning.
Yeah.
You can get up with all power in your hand. Why? Because the Lord said, the work that I've done, greater work shall you do. And where did it all start? In the family of God.
Yeah.
Coming down to generation and generation and generation. Tell your children, and let your children tell their children, and let your children's children tell their children, and let your children's children's children tell their children. If it had not been for the Lord.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. We need to know that we don't need to look any further, for that which you seek, you have found. You found Jesus, right?
Yes.
Wrong. Jesus found you.
Yes.
Jesus found me. When I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Pastor. All right. Despair.
See how we put words in other people's mouths when we love them?
That's called sin. Am I? Hallelujah. So we don't need to look any further. He found you. Don't keep looking and searching and looking at all the stuff that glitters that's not gold. Let's stop chasing the tail around and around in a circle. We're supposed to be the head, not the tail. Stop chasing your tail in a circle in Rama. Not going that way. But we know that God is in charge. And he said in his word that he would make us the head and not the tail. When he said we would be above and not beneath. If you heed his commandments today. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Praise him.
Look high and low. Still couldn't find nobody, nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low. Nobody greater, nobody greater, nobody greater than you. His name is above all names. Your name is above all names.
Your name is above all names.
You're worthy of all our praise.
You're worthy.
Saul, God. We thank you, God, that you can turn around even our situations, God. We have a desperate cry to you this morning, God. A name led us here today, God. But it wasn't our grandparents, God. It wasn't our sisters. It wasn't our brothers, God. But it was your name. We follow your sheep, know your voice, God. So we thank you today, God. We thank you, God, for looking over your sheep, God. And though, God, we were black, though, God, we were striving, God, though, God, we were empty, God, though, God, we were wrestling, God, though, God, we were dysfunctional, God, though, God, we were upset, God, though, God, we were frustrated, God, though, God, we had a tale of our own, God. We thank you that your name called us in the mighty of the works of your hands, God. We couldn't have gotten out of our situation by ourselves, God. We couldn't have solved the puzzle, God. We couldn't have eliminated death, God. We couldn't have got healed by ourselves, God. We couldn't have gotten out of that bad relationship, God. We couldn't have stood up against molestation, God. We couldn't have took back incest, God. But God, your name covered. We thank you for covering us, God. Your name is above all things.
Thank you.